10 seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time. Dire team ban. Radiant team ban. Ten seconds remaining.
I should have seen that one coming.
Dire team ban. Ten seconds remaining.
Hello everybody, and welcome back to Dota Pit Season 4 by G2AI. I'm Tubby Warner, and I'm your host for our last game. That is right, there is no more after this point. The online qualifier for Dota Pit. Who will travel to Croatia? Will it actually be Roxkiss? If they win this game, they will qualify. If they do not, then Team Empire will go, remaining as the highest points in the grid, in the group stage, in whatever you want to call it. The man casting with me tonight, who will actually give me words which are more direct, it is my co-caster, Ryu. Welcome back, man.
Nah, Toby makes all the right calls, guys. I'm just here for the hype.
Let's do this!
You gotta do it right, you gotta do it right. Like, it's with the rising hold. Hype! Like, you hold it back and you rise at the same time.
Hype!
Just can't. I don't even know what that one was.
I wanted to do the, do you know James Durbin?
10 seconds remaining.
He's like an American Idol singer. He's kind of famous for his, like, that.
If you want someone that's Reserve famous for that time. Kind of stuff that I would recognize, I would instantly say the Bee Gees.
Sometimes I'm just don't know some references to certain old singers. I forget.
It's the Bee Gees!
I can't even remember one of their song names. But if I listened to it, I would have heard at least four or five of their songs.
That's it. I'm out. This is yours.
What? No, it's like actors in Hollywood. Sometimes I just don't know who the hell they are unless I see them.
I actually need a moment as well, man. I need a moment. Something's gone wrong over here, so take the draft away.
All right, guys. Come in here, guys. This is a little bit intimate right now. It's just you and me, no Toby, and just good stuff right now. So we got Roxkiss handing out the Lone Druid and the Chin. They're going to be picking up the Nature's Prophet as well as the Vengeful Spirit. And then we have Hellraisers. Hopefully they'll get back on track this game. They had a good showing last time. Earth Spirit was banned out by them, as well as the Oracle. Batrider being picked up here. And then last but not least, what will they go next? Last time was Witch Doctor. Be seeing the same picks here. Guess I'll just say the same thing I said last game. Nature's Prophet, as Toby said, can just show up to many different lanes. Gank potential is there. We saw how much work Ghostic did in the later stages of the game. Obviously applying so much flip push and pressure.
Radiant team ban.
Venge had some really great swaps, saving a lot of the Spectre Pronode hero. Batrider had a lot of really good plays there from Alpha and NG in the mid lane. I was very surprised it worked out as well as it did. They just needed to get their blink dagger online, and then he was just a monster. And then this time, they're going to have some reliable lockdown once again in the Bane. I liked the Witch Doctor a little bit for last game for the heal, but, I mean, he just got blown up so fast. He couldn't even heal things up. That was a nightmare for him. Bane, though. He's going to help out a lot in this early game stage. He can put pressure anywhere, set up kills. And then they're not going to go full global this time. Oh, no. No Zeus. I think Zeus is probably the biggest component to global strats. just allows you to have so much vision around the map. You set that up, and then it gives vision for the Furion. It's, say Furion plus Spectre have good synergy. You just use Spectre ulti, and then you can use the Furion ulti, but... Talked about it last game. I really like Spectres coming in after, you know, 2-3 seconds after the fight's already initiated, right? So like Avenge Stun and Swap or something, and then you initiate. I don't like it kind of initiating. We saw how bad it was for the team fight during the mid-tier 2 during that ancient spot to the right on the Dire side. And then Tornado Rocks, they just got 4-man wiped, and Illidan was a monster from that point on. But
5 seconds.
Cody, man out here. Hope he's an asshole. Still hasn't come back.
I'm sorry, did you miss me?
I actually was thinking you were there. That's why I said that.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
I literally only just managed to get back with my headset in, so... yeah.
Man, I'm so good. Oh, I just... Those timing windows.
Dire team pick.
How do I feel like we're going down the same road as last game?
I said that. I said all they needed is the Witch Doctor for Hellraisers, and it would have been the same draft.
No, I'm kind of happier that they actually get the Bane point, because the Witch Doctor kind of, like, I didn't really feel his influence in the last game. The paralyzing cast were soaked up by the massive amount of treants that were on the field.
Talked about it too, like the Witch Doctor just got blew up, and his heal couldn't even come online, and as well as the death ulties, it was on like supports and stuff. It wasn't very big or impactful.
Yeah, it actually has more like realistic HP instead of like that all. I can regenerate it over time. As having brain sap is instant. The ability to actually screw around with Vengeful Spirit when you get that nightmare as well can stop it. Like, and I really hope they don't go faceless Void Hellraisers. Because VS is just so damn good against that. You don't want to kill her. If you kill her, your entire lineup has negative damage. And then you're actually having to kill off the core, which you started to try to kill off, but you already committed all your abilities to kill him. So that's not going to work.
It's just so much more beneficial when Roxas actually do this lineup on Dire. I mean, it just makes everything come together so easily. Hellraisers, we saw it last time. They got a good pick off. They had Swarm into the Desolator finished on Weaver. That was his time to shine there at the Roche Pit. And then now they have Venge plus Nature's Prophet. I mean, that sets up a lot already for the Roche Pit with the minus armor as well as the Treants. So we'll have to see if that will help them out for that mid-game pressure or what's going to happen here. Honestly, the Weaver was so good last game from Illidan. It just looked like he... I don't want to say throw, but it really did look like
I'm going to put it this way. I think this is probably the most political way we can put it.
All right, that's the political style.
Okay. He was in peril more than what was required.
Yes, that's, I like that. I like that.
I think that's the best way to put it. He was in peril more than what was required. That's the best way.
Yeah, at least he was getting off his ulties, right? Where he wasn't blatantly dying to Zeus Bolt ulti.
Yeah. 5 seconds. Oh. He definitely pushed the envelope. Eternal Envy would be proud.
He pushed it so much that... Okay, I'm not going to say anything.
You had the bad pun in your head, didn't you? You heard that. He pushed the envelope so hard, it never delivered. Lost in customs. Couldn't pay the fare.
Screw customs, man.
We tried getting something here in America, in Germany from... I had someone...
I did. It cost me like 100.
I had to travel to the customs office, which is on the side of Berlin. I had to pay $150 for something which only cost 40.
Get wrecked. Oh my goodness, that sounds worse.
The item wasn't available in Germany. It was reserve just so expensive. Time. To import it because it's a special unique item. It was a snuggie.
Dire team ban.
The heck's a snuggie, dude?
It's like a blanket with arms.
Ah, snuggie. Sounds like something you give to your baby. There you go, snuggie.
It's something marketed to families. And yeah,
10 seconds.
Someone who I knew in America at the time was like, "Man, this is the greatest thing ever. You gotta have it."
5 seconds.
And I'm just like, "Do I? Do I really? I've still got it."
Is it good? You like it?
I have used it once. I felt so foolish, I never used it again.
Is it because it looks like you have, so you put your arms in, like, the blanket thing, and it just looks silly, and it's like, ah, goo goo gaga, I'm just clapping my hands together,
like,
a dinosaur.
Between Sesame Street and the Teletubbies. Visually. Obviously not intellectually. Make you dumber by wearing it. Okay, we're rapidly remaining. Approaching the end of our draft. The CK
casting
combo.
With Toby makes me dumber.
I'm sorry, all of a sudden, I'm 2K! What am I, 2K? I don't even care about Dota anymore. That's it, like, it's only CSGO from here.
We're just gonna talk about random stuff.
No, CSGO. It's CSGO, because obviously, if you cast with me, you're obviously a CSGO caster.
Oh yeah, alright. I first need to learn the game.
We're gonna talk about cricket. Australian Open for the tennis. We have to have a chat about that. We have to
Brandon Williams would be proud of you.
10 seconds remaining.
I think that's the only person I saw
Five
on tennis.
Seconds remaining.
Like, so in America, I watched tennis like I don't know about Reserve 7 or 8 time. Years ago on the TV, and there was just like, I looked at the NFL Radiant or the network. It was ESPN. And there was just like Sabrina Williams, best girl tennis player ever. And I had watched her, and she's like, "Hoo-ah!" I was like, "Holy shit!"
There was a lot of discussion when they came onto the scene that like question mark of were they doing certain drugs to make themselves a lot more butch? Mark that came with those girls. But no, I grew up in the age of refined. For anyone out there who recognizes this name, don't worry, we'll talk about the draft and the game in just a moment. It's loaded. Don't worry, we've got you covered. But I grew up in the age of Martina Hingis. And when Pat Rafter was number one. So they were my two favorite tennis players. Martina Hingis, such a great style. I believe she was Swiss.
Okay. I just watched tennis for a little bit. It's looks okay.
Okay, so let's talk about our draft, because we're about to load into it. So we're going to get a Puck Viper matchup in mid. We get a Nature's Prophet off lane against... Actually, that's assuming the Viper's going to go mid. They could actually run a CK-Wiz combo against the Puck, which would annoy him. Batrider may have a couple of problems with the off lane. Ironicus, the Wisp, and the Wyvern. The VS and the Wyvern. Really good at just zoning out in the lane. So I'm a little concerned about that front, which is why I'm actually leaning more towards the Wisp and CK mid. Then the Wisp is at least capable of stacking for the Batrider.
But it's weird though, if you pick Viper in this situation, normally you... I don't know if you want to necessarily put it in the mid lane.
Yeah,
right?
You put it safe lane. Put a safe lane with the Bane. It's so dangerous for the Prophet too. Like, you just get caught out by a nightmare. If you don't have your Treant summoned up, you may be caught out. But if you are nightmare for a full duration, the Viper just repositions himself and gets full times of poison attacks out. And probably if you don't lose a large majority of your life, you'll lose the whole thing.
The biggest problem though is Viper can crush a Puck one-on-one. Already, and then Nature's Prophet would get a lot from the offlane with a Viper and a Bane there.
You don't think that combo would be enough? It looks like they are just going to run the CK Wisp on the safe lane.
I think it's like it's kind of like the Wisp tiny, but at the same time, if you pick this Viper and you put it safe lane, you're just giving Ghostick way too much in the offlane. Like he's going to get away with murder. But if you have this Wisp here, who's going to constantly give mana to the CK, you're going to be able to Reality Rift, stun him up so he can't TP away. Okay,
is this an aggro tri-lane? Okay. Illidan's going to be here. Tether comes out from the IO, trying to help the CK to escape. The orb's going to fly down. It connects on both of them. Verifies being committed, and CK, they'll get back in range of the tower. You stop at least the first blood. Escape the attack from rocks, but yeah, it looks like Nature's Prophet Ghostick was moving to the top lane up against the Batrider, and then they run this aggro off lane. But Ghostick's now going to move down to the bottom lane.
Seems a little bit silly. then you're just giving Batrider free levels, and then obviously talked about it already, the Puck will not do as great as the Viper will, and then one turnaround because of the Bane, you know, brain sap. You're gonna get two runes for this, so that's really well, like, that's good that they kind of engage there, and Batrider's gonna have a really nice time. So, yeah, realizing this, they're gonna go for a smoke.
I think Afro misclicked. He, just consumed his fairy fire. That was after he picked up the bounty rune. God damn, you need something to tether to. Someone come over and help this Io, he's too far away. God damn, just needs to pull, but he can't do it. Iron Man, as well as y'all, claim the first blood in favor of Rocky.
That's still pretty good, though. You keep your Viper alive. I'm not saying it's great, but keeping your mid lane alive, it's nice. And they didn't even ward up anything, so he can still go back to stacking if he really wants to. But at the end of the day, not bad. And as well as top lane, Batrider getting levels. I think that's a really good play for Hellraiser.
Coming up for Yol, up for him though. Yol got scattered out by the Observer Ward, so Sharshlo is already there waiting for him.
But you don't normally see those plays anymore onto the mid lane. Normally you just give away too much to the off lane in these situations. Sharshlo is way too aggressive now, okay.
Missile? Yep. Do some easy chip damage, they're not going to find a kill. If you're really looking to commit, Tron would have probably Spectral Daggered at the very, very start. RMM went into that Arctic Burn.
So the lane is pushed, and that's why you see Sharshlo, yeah, playing really aggressive right now. He also knows Yol just went away, so this is just easy time for him.
Experience is gold, it's no risk.
And meanwhile, we have Ghostick, level 1. Just jungling.
Well, too soon. When he can finally kill off the Satyr, but now he's actually made his life a little bit more difficult. Yeah, he had to get the back off so he can keep doing this. I actually thought for a moment he had more levels up, so he'd actually have 3 treants, but... okay. Bane's about to make a crack for mid. CZ's only got phase shift and orb, so no rift, there's no silence to work with. Same time, Yol's trying to prepare to attack into Afro. Both are fairly low, BZZ as well as Afro, and then he just proper's gonna TP in. Starting it up, Afro gets the treat line, south with cancel, he's got himself another fairy fire, commits it already, and now the tether arrives from Goddamn, brings him to the front lines, you'll get a revenge kill out from the Bane. He does love his nightmare available, Goddamn, BZZ, he gets the last attack in as that puck. If you can. Finds the kill, and the Bane, well, he's gonna actually get completely juked. The phase shift drawn away from BZZ will get him out safely.
Nice rotations coming in from Roxas, and that's just where you punish the Viper. And he doesn't have any tangos. He really needs to have some for the sprouts that can be coming up. BZZ gonna have his boots and bottle now, but not gonna ferry him out.
Kind of funny as well to see an Aegis Prophet do a gank like that when he doesn't have sprout, because he went for a 0-1-2 build. Set.
More so just having the body blocks there available, and as well as just adding another body to tank the tower shots. It helps out a lot when you do these big dives, as well as... I was really surprised that the Wisp came in and then he was like, alright, got him, I'm gonna go fight the Puck. But wait, I don't have any balls, so I can't do any damage to the Puck. And then he just died.
Into this, all knowing what he was getting, like, there was an observer board that was watching that movement of rocks. He's got friends in the neighborhood, so we probably felt confident enough.
Honestly, they could have killed two supports there if Wisp had tethered onto the high ground. It's just he really wanted the rune for Gotham.
Still a level 2 Wisp who has overcharge and tether.
But still, they had 2 or 3 stacks. Fawn was coming over. It's one of those plays that are like, okay, well, they have magic wand charges, so they can easily turn around on us, and it might not be enough, like you said.
Sick has an invis rune right now. I don't think he did. Bane just passes Nature's Prophet. It is nighttime vision, so it's not terrific.
Dire's
actually allow the Bane to come
attack.
Up and potentially lead some levels and then just harass the Nature's Prophet. Man, this CK's got so much space. 34 for 20. Being his last hits and denies.
Yeah, they're pushing this bottom lane. They also have a TP here, so this is a lot of pressure that could get... Oh, lucky bastard. Two CK illusions.
Blitter Blast went slow this down. Bane's still trying to move into position where he can go for a gank. There's treants all over the field, so this Nightmare shouldn't set up anything. RMM will be freed, and they're TPing in support. There goes your Dream Call, catching out Illidan. The tether comes in from Goddamn, but now with the double rift, as well as the orb connecting Wave of Terror, Goddamn's got practically
boots?
No armor.
Fire boots?
He's bottling up as quick as he possibly can. And there's a TP in from Ghostix.
Dire's bottom
tower. Gets the kill. Rock Spring, almost everyone apart from the Spectre. Just about to hit level 6, by the way.
Yeah, they just didn't have any mana to really run them down. As well as the coil was just kind of already used. Nothing else to really chase, but still that's good. 4-1 now on the board. It's just, is it enough, right, for Rock's Kiss? Because they're going to have to, they're gonna reach this timing window when Hellraisers are going to have a mech online. They're going to have Fiend's Grip. They're going to have Lasso. They can single out targets. Box Kiss though.
That's
top lane.
Zone. Like, if they can survive that, I'm going to feel a lot more confident for them. Now, Nightmare. Outrider does not have Lasso, but there's three sticky napalm charges already. Bron's going to try and outrun this. Where's the Flame Break? It's not there. Now you can add five sticky napalm charges. They just can't catch him down. So, Ghostix, he's the one on the front lines. He's fine. It's more of a distraction than anything else to combine it with Yul. Harshlow, successful TP out. Bane will not be so lucky, however. And again, now, what's happened here? Rocks rotate all heroes to the bottom lane, try and find a kill after the aggression came from Hellraisers. Hellraisers then lose Wisp. Now Rocks TP everyone to the top lane. Try and defend after an engagement, and Hellraisers lose an Iron. Rocks aren't getting the cores for these 5 kills they've got.
And they're getting the tier 1 tower bottom lane. This is so good from Hellraisers, to just putting pressure where they know they can with the supports. And even though they're not getting the kills, they're making them waste big ulties and a lot of time.
Time's the biggest thing. And you said it yourself, Hellraisers have that sweet spot before Rocks gets to really be fully online. All they have to do is just keep building up their items until they're ready to fight. I'm wondering if Illidan also wants to go directly into Armlet in this game. Picked up Tracer, which makes me lean towards a drum build for him.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack.
He didn't get lucky with that Phantasm, he only got one illusion. Jorian looking at the kill on Iron Man.
Four seconds.
And he gets a crit hit. TP support's on the way, but you've got around the corner from both the Bane as well as the Wisp.
He should have baited that out a little bit more. Maybe just turn around and attack them.
Yep.
So you can do a lot of cool things too. Cancel your Chaos Bolt to really make him use his phase shift. And then if he does, oh boy. You're going to have to do a really cute illusionary jaunt. Somebody died.
There's no more Venom out from the Spectre. It's the phase boots, but it was like 3-4 hits for the Batrider to go down. Also, force a rotation out from Goddamn. He tried to get there in time to help out the Batrider, but it was just a little bit too late. And it is just going to be the straight armlet from Illidan. Already on the rotation to middle lane, looking for the kill over on Yul. Break out of the tower. 3 seconds stun. Is there a crit? Is there a crit? Where's the crit? No crit. Viper will still take the kill anyway.
Yep. It's just a really good game, like you said, just to go armlet. It buffs up CK so much, especially when you're with a Wisp. That just, you know, negates all of that feeling that, you know, you're lost. So you just get it right back up, and then the amount of damage you can do is, it's worth it. It's like having, obviously, a Huskar. But in this situation, you're just going to have, like, 3 or 4 CKs. And... Nope. I skanked there from Illidan just pressuring in the mid lane, and because Pawk has been rotating around so much from BZZ, he has no time to get anything. They haven't put any pressure on the Viper, and he's just keeping the lane stable constantly, so he's just getting free farm, and he's making sure that Pawk can't come back mid. There's no way he can even CS in this situation.
But BZZ has to rotate. He has to come in and make these dream calls go to work. Like, they're looking for a kill on the bottom lane up against...
Dire's middle tower is under attack.
The smoke can move down for it. Is the Bane is still in the neighborhood, and again, another movement from Rox will result in the death of a support hero of Hellraiser's. Given the Spectral Haunt being used, he's looking for a kill on Goddamn, but the Spectral Dagger is well off target. Therefore, he's gonna rotate. Luckily for Tron, he runs north. Yeah, again, but Rox make another move, and the support goes down. They still keep failing to find the core heroes of Hellraiser's.
Yeah. They got level 6 now. Oh, yoles.
Reality Rift. 3 seconds on the stun. He's still got Illidan getting stunned up himself. Goddamn's a little bit too deep. Gonna tether himself up, down, and away from the puck. Attack still followed. BZZ, a nice phase shift. Is able to dodge out the attack of Afo. Which means he doesn't get slowed down, and there's no way for HR to keep the chase going.
Did you see that relocate in, though?
That was the one that came up, like, up here. All the part.
Then he just died off because the Puck just right clicked him and stuff, and the Wave of Terror helped out. Go Puck Illusions. Stronger than CK Illusions. But, yep, there's just way too much sustain now from Hellraisers. This is when they're gonna be super strong, and they really need Wyvern ulti.
CK's finished his full armlet. If they want to, they can just keep pressuring mid. Damn just needs to have a bottle. Like a bottle charge and a couple of stick charges, and he can keep that CK alive if things get rough.
Radiant's bottom tower.
Force things out with the armlet because there isn't enough burst damage from Rox to do anything about it. And looks like they're actually going to use that overward they've already planted down. Try and come for a kill on Tron. And he doesn't see it coming, he sees Goddamn on the top lane, but already backing up.
Blink dagger complete here on Shashlo. Just going to pick it up. And fight over the rune.
D1 for the Banter. Still a regeneration on bottom river, so it's not that bad. Earth 6 would probably want to take that one. He's fairly low at the moment. Fight. Alright, so HR's not going to take the engagement the Rox want to. They're going to try and force out this top lane, check through the trees. Not a good thing to reveal as well, the fact that your Firefly is now on cooldown. He actually hasn't come in range of the tower, so Rox aren't aware of this. But they're not really interested. They're looking for a tower trade-off. Tier 1 for a tier 1.
Nah, I just don't see how Rox gets win a straight-up team fight anymore. I honestly can't find it.
Just dodge.
Yeah, you're gonna have to dodge a lot with the Furion, but... Even so, you're going to get relocated on, so the best thing is either baiting, you either bait out the relocate and with your Furion, or you try to go for a sneaky Roche play for Roxkist. Else you're just going to keep losing your tier 2 towers, or even Hellraisers might go into the Roche pit soon.
Fireflying with a blink. Whoops! Shashlo thought he already had his target last turn. Now he'll get it off, so Yol's TP unsuccessful, the Puck not going to join himself into this fight. Yes, we'll go down to the Viper.
Dyer's
so difficult for Roxkiss to try and contest, because the mech is already on the Viper, so any damage they did would be negated almost instantly, and they're being, like, pressured up on the top lane.
Dyer's top tower is under attack.
I guess the one big thing about this Winter Wyvern is that's going to be amazing is once the CK gets like 3-4 illusions and then he starts killing himself.
Oh, yes, the solo curse, Illidan, the Sprout down as well, Illidan, continuously silenced, but there's that mech effect I was talking about. All the initial damage, or almost practically all of it, coming out from Rox isn't enough to get the kill, and they're able to kite back out. The Splinter Blast flies again. The Puck with the Illusionary Orb doesn't find his target. Illidan just starts armlet toggling. No BZZs in the trees, but Hellraisers, there's no need for them to force the issue any further than they have. Illidan's already way too low. almost all of Hellraiser's is, and they got the kill on the Spectre and the Wyvern, surviving two major ultimates from Rox.
I mean, that was the perfect situation for Roxkiss. I mean, there wasn't any Fiend's Grip used, the Wisp wasn't even there, he had to kind of like relocate in, and then when he showed up to the team fight, he only had 100 HP, so he couldn't even fully charge Illidan's batteries. And I'm not even... I'm so worried for Roxas this game. I mean, last game it looked like Hellraiser's kind of might have given it to them, but this time they're on the money. Like, this is their game, not to lose again, but Roxas have to do a lot of sneaky things. Like I said, you have to bait out, you're gonna have to smoke into Roche. Some kind of play here.
See the Roshan happening, but not totally. She's still going up against a Batrider. Wisp can throw a couple of spirits across. There's ways that Hellraiser can go for it. The one thing which is working in Rox's favor is the fact that HR don't have a bunch of aggressive observer wards on the Dire side of the map. So, understanding when Rox do go missing or do slip into Roshan, that's a lot harder to work out. Probably the reason why Goddamn is here. Here to throw down the observer wards. You scout the Roshan's alive. The pings are coming to that rider to say, can you please come down here? DK is not terrific against Roshan, primarily because his ultimate does nothing against Roshan. He still does a fair chunk of damage with that armor on him.
Yeah.
I don't think Illidan's gonna be sad about it.
The only big thing that they have to really do here... BZZ can get the kill here if they just Shurion ulti. But... you need to be careful because Bane's here.
It's still a 3-on-1, and now he understands the other two heroes are rotating over. So Goddamn puts the spirits down, but BZZ blinks very nicely into the other lad. So, no way for the Wisp time.
Alright, they're split up right now. Venge and Spectre in mid lane. This is really good play still from Rox. Obviously TP in, you just swap away. Mid top, Yara still have the Armin, kind of babysitting the Furion. So Winter Curse can really help with disengage, but they've smoked that middle here.
Here comes the relocate as well. They really want to catch out Tron, but they don't find anyone. Yol was able to walk away in time. Wrath of Vayne does bounce around them, and well, they see Tron running far west. They need more movement speed. Wisp has to go back, breaking his relocate now with the Haunt. Where do you want to go, Real Spectre? Reality back in again, a 4 second stun out from Illidan on top of Tron. The Dream Call has to find more space here. Where's that armlet toggle with the Phantasm? More illusions to appear on the fight, but now Illidan, that toggle, he just can't do it. The 3 second stun is there on the Spectre as Apo makes a run for this. Darshlo's looking for the target, and he's finally found it. It's going to be Tron. The swap back for the damage from Apo is going to be too much. The Batrider, however, gets completely bursted down by Rox, but Apo is just way too big. He Viper Strikes RMM, knowing that RMM was going to tick out, and then moves up for the Vengeful Spirit as well. A great presence of mind from the Viper, just understanding how much he could pull out of that situation.
Maximum efficiency.
Got everything. Like, he did everything in that fight.
I mean, he did everything in last game too. He's like, what are my Tard allies doing costing me games? He's amazing on the Batrider last time, and then this time, obviously it's a Viper. Disgusting stuff, but BZZ, okay. I mean, that's... I mean, this is the kind of plays you have to make, though. You have to slow down these creep waves as much as you can. Get in their heads that I'm everywhere on the map as Puck. But... yeah, now it's going to be very scary. Illidan has the potential for 2 to 3 illusions. I think the biggest thing right now, though, is still got him. He's getting really low all the time on his Wisp, and he just can't really help out with the sustain.
You can understand it when you got a Spectre on your tally getting hit by Wrath of Nature all the time, and you're in so close that you're in range of Dreamcoil.
He's just food. But he's got 1400 gold here, so if he gets a Glimmer Cape...
would be nice. That's an invisible Wisp, by the way, just so if you don't see the debuff.
He's blind. Wyvern's blind. Dragon, he's too old. Can't see. Relocate bottom. Okay, here we go. Ghost stick. Got the balls going out. Stun.
Didn't get the proper vision off. Now Afro's in trouble. gonna one-shot, still has the mech available. Darshlow is in range, so they both can actually get the mech, and Illidan now arrives. Just 3 seconds on over an Iron Man, and Afo keeps the damage going with the rest of his team. It's a double kill already for BZZ, however, as he jumps into the middle of the Firefly and back in range of the Viper. He'll actually phase shift out a little bit of that attack, but now Afo pumps it into Ghostix. There's still not enough. Darshlow trying to fight this, but the Fiend Script is there from the paint. Ghostix can't escape until Iron Man gives him a little bit of space, but only because he went for the full ultimate. But that doesn't stop Darshlow from getting the triple kill. An entire team wipe against Roxkiss. It definitely wasn't clean by Hellraisers, but it was the good type of dirty for them.
Oh yeah, baby. Give me that Batrider triple kill there at the end of the day. Give me my four staff and send me to the bank. Nope. It was just still kind of sloppy. They try to get a good play down there on the Furion, just DP's way, and then he just shows up to the team fight in middle lane. Really good plays coming out from BZZ. He's 6-1 right now, and his puck doing as much as he can. It's just a really hard puck game right now. Illidan keeps getting silenced at all these inopportune moments. He really needs to have a Mantha style. Really needs that, and he's way too aggressive right now.
Well, maybe not so. When you've got that many Phantasm Illusions trying to beat the BS, there is that protection, however. The cold embrace onto Yol. The Illusions still finish the job, even though the Master may be dead. Okay, they have enough. The Spectre. Viper Strike is just too much. You can't walk away with that. Afro with the high movement speed arriving from the Wisp and now departing from the Wisp. It still brought him in range to kill off Iron Man. And they'll finish up the tier 2 tower as well. Actually, even attacking the tower.
I feel like Illidan is the offlane this game. He definitely isn't the core.
He feels like the offlane. Like, he feels like the old role of the offlane. Like that jump in initiator that soaks up all the damage, but doesn't matter if he dies.
He's like, I'm a man.
Y'all's not a man. No.
He's a dead man.
The Observer Ward was already down. Shaw knew exactly what was coming their way. And what the hell is BZZ gonna do, Shashlo?
No. It's fine, he had Blink Dagger away anyway, so BZZ wanted to die.
Shashno. That's not Dream. Now we get to sit up on top of this hillside, contemplating his thoughts for 5 seconds.
So what's Illidan do now? He's farming, actually. That's very surprising for me.
Illidan? He gets BKB. That's pretty much it. Like, he just gets BKB and continues to do exactly what he was doing.
He's not a BKB buyer in this game. He's gonna go Manta. I agree that BKB would be amazing this game, but he's gonna go. Yeah.
You're right, there's the Usher. Well, unless he converts into SMY. Just thinking whatever else he can get to stay on the front lines and cause real problems. I suppose like 5 million case would help with that front.
It's very unfortunate that Shashlo went over the right side.
Oh, the curse. Iron Man, goddamn! Illidan as well as Afro turn on their teammate. Reality for pullback in Iron Man. 3 second stun, so it's a 1-foot trade-off.
That was close. Almost got the TP away.
A very sneaky play, and there's no curse for now 100 seconds.
They can relocate in 20 and help out.
Potentially. Right now, Illidan's already attacking into that tier 3 tower.
The only reason they got that was because of the gym. They wouldn't have got that kill because he would have made the flame break miss because of the reality. Go Hell Razors. Go Empire. No, I'm just kidding. I'm not like that.
BZZ. To jump in. Illidan, here comes that special horn. They're looking for their big target. Illidan still hasn't even turned on. Now he'll turn on the armlet. He's got the help of the freshly relocated in Wisp. For the VS down, the Wyvern's gonna respawn. Remember, there's still no curse. Goddamn. Nice having you here. He'll go all the way back to base. They haven't finished with the melee racks. Great Fiend Strip, followed by a 3 second stun. The Cold Embrace will protect BZZ. They go for the Brain Sap, but there's not enough damage. At least Strong gets controlled up by the Nightmare. BZZ's taking way too much damage. Afo, he's already committed the mech, so Afo will finally die here. It's taken so long for this to happen, but he's still done a fair chunk of damage. RN burning inside the Firefly. The Nightmare to keep Tron out of this. Illidan He's got the urn ticking him down. He wants to armlet toggle. Unfortunately, he just cannot do it while the consistent damage is coming his way. But the melee Rex dies on bottom lane. But advantage still has to be given to Hellraisers for that. Just forcing the lanes and the buyback to come out from the puck.
Yeah, you're forced into, I feel like, going for this Roche no matter what. This is the only chance they really have. This game, where's the Furion TP? And I was just talking about Ghostick. He had like 3.5k during that team fight and he didn't spend it. They're just gonna...
Sorry, it looks like Chrome was locked in a wall.
Oh yeah.
But yeah, sorry, your thing? Gold.
Is this the right play though? Maximum amount of split push here from the Axe Furion?
I think it's their only option. They've got to keep Hellraisers looking behind themselves to give time for the rest of their teammates to pick up some critical items. Fireman can pick up this Blink Dagger. He's kind of got everything he's really searching to have. It looks like a... Wait, is this a Dagon build from the Puck? I wouldn't be against it. I'm not sure I'm for it, but...
It'll be Yul still. I mean, at this situation where you're about to lose the game, you might want to go for it because you... I still think you should just save for Yul's. Even saving for... Well, he did just use buyback, so that's going to be on cooldown for 5 minutes here, but...
Uh-huh.
Yeah, you have to get the Yul's. It's just... So...
That just makes sense. It's going to lose out so much while they... While they wait for him to get the remaining money.
Yeah, I'm back, baby.
You're alive again. Pre-spawn. Yeah, but with Ghostix throwing out this ulti, like, all the time, he's able to keep momentum in the side lanes, keep Hellraisers looking behind themselves. Hellraisers are pretty good defending against the split push, but it's still requiring both Goddamn as well as Illidan to be in that side lane, pushing it out. Obviously, Wrath of Nature pushes out multiple lanes at the same time.
Yeah, it's gonna be a problem if they don't have it up for the team fights, but I think it is a really good Axe game because of everything you said, as well as the fact that you can't split push anymore. There's a Batrider on the field, there's a Wisp and a CK. The only way you're going to get split push off is with an ulti coming in from Nature's Prophet.
You're up after Sharshlo. Going for the Observe Warp, able to find one straight away. Now he's going to get the hell out of there. The Observe Warp that HR left behind inside the Dire base, it saw four heroes grouping up on bottom lane. Which is why Afo, as well as the Bane, are now making a beeline for that tier 2 tower up on top. Aramis here to do the same thing he did before. Waiting in the tree line. Doesn't have a TP scroll, only got the Glimmer Cape. Oh god, they don't...
Gonna do the whole bat stab.
I don't know how.
You just Glimmer Cape and then run this way. And then the team fight will occur here. Be a little bit careful.
It's gonna be difficult. Now we see if HR make the same mistake they made previously. Not respecting the high ground defense of rocks. In this case, most of it's still surrounded by like a good swap, a green coil, and a good curse. But the extra damage that comes from the Prophet and the Spectre is good, but obviously. I think it's all about the control when you have a team going high ground. You hold them too deep inside your base. And now, Blink Lasso. Oh, that's the great start. You bring down the VS. There's no buyback for him. And Spectre just bought a Radiance. Now, Tron does have the Aegis Immortal. That's why he's being so aggressive with this. But you got so many Illidans. And they pull in Tron. That Aegis doesn't last all. Not to mention PZZ in the middle of this fight. He'll jump out. He'll Yule Scepter up to keep himself alive. Goddamn, it's almost able to survive through most of this too. The Mage Charge coming in is a little bit too late. They've lost the Spectre twice over. They've lost Ghostix. BZZ comes in for one last hurrah. And he's already taken too much damage from Corrosive Skin. The Firefly burns him out. And I think that's actually a good game. You've just lost two side lanes of ranks. And there's no buybacks available right now for Roxkiss, which means you'll be facing up against Megas fairly soon.
Yeah, that no TP on Wyvern is game losing. Now you see why you carry TP, folks. took him way too long to get into the team fight. He needed to just TP to this tier 3 tower, Glimmer Cape, and immediately go in, and then he would have crushed that team fight. They could have found out the right CK. But that's the hard part, right? It was only the Wisp and then the CK illusions all hitting the building, so the Viper was really far back, the other heroes, so they did really good positioning there from Hellraisers for the Armin first. And like you said, this is... I mean, Roxas, they don't want to give up, they just got eliminated, but... Oh.
They're giving it a shot. Illidan, well, already. Mana style, dodges a lot. That Cold Embracer can't protect the VS long enough. And with the drag back, Tron's down again. Another minute on the sideline. Illidan trying to force the issue. Puck at least able to get in behind the line. He's also going to get a free kill on a courier.
They got a greater treant right here.
I want to
use it.
A courier snipe.
Look at the greater tree.
Dead. Nightmare him until the Fiend's Grip comes off cooldown. BCC is dead. Minute on the sideline. They've still got that range racks on bottom lane to kill, but then Megas will arrive for Hellraisers, and then this game is, it's not defensible. Rocks.
The unattainable dream.
Iron Man's still gonna try and make a play for it. Runs in. Gets himself a three-man curse.
Stop helping him, Gotham. What the hell?
Elden moves up. Goes to Prophet, the Cold Embrace. And Phantasm is back off cooldown. Damage output just completely skyrockets. And that's gonna be the Rax down. There's Megas. And good game, well played. Hellraisers fight to the bitter end. Don't give Rocks the free walkthrough with a 2-0 victory, which means Team Empire, they will be the ones to qualify through, taking the number one position in the Group A of the European qualifier. Na'Vi took out number one position in Group B, and that gives us MVP from the Southeast Asian region and Complexity from the North American region. Combining up with the four direct invites is shaping up to be one hell of a land for Dota Pit. Make sure you get your tickets if you haven't done so.